Mon nom est Wab Kenu et puis je travaille ici comme le vice-président associé pour les affaires autochtones. My name is Wab Kenu, Wabanaquit Nigo, and I'm the associate vice president of Indigenous Affairs here at the University of Winnipeg. So I'd like to welcome you all and thank you all for being here today. This is the I believe the fifth lecture in our Weweni Indigenous speaker series. Weweni is an Ojibwe word, which means like to do something properly or to take care. And we named it that because it's one of the few Ojibwe words that is less than 20 syllables long. But we, in a serious level, like we want our students here like to have that kind of experience while they're on campus, like to do well, and but also to take care of themselves and to focus on health and wellness and well-being, intellectually, physically, spiritually, emotionally, and all that good stuff. So we have a very, very interesting topic and a very distinguished speaker today, Dr. Adam Gaudry. And I think that all the chatter online about his talk has sort of been an indication of how kind of interesting this subject is. So we're really looking forward to it, and we really thank you all for coming. Just one quick housekeeping thing. Please check out Sarah Dean, who works with me in my office at the back of the room, if you haven't already, to sign up for our mailing list. And again, if you are an Indigenous student here at the University of Winnipeg, you can get a pin that says UW Indigenous on it. It's a silver pewter-colored pin. If you finish your four-year degree on time within 4 years, we'll give you a gold one. So come and register with us, and you can get that kind of incentive. And I want to give them away, so come, sign up, do your full course load, and graduate on time, and we'll be glad to hook you up. So we are also co-presenting this today with the Louis Riel Institute, which is sort of, I guess, one of the very important educational institutions in the city and province here, but also I think is sort of like the body with which we exercise the relationship with the education direction of the Manitoba Métis Federation. And so on behalf of, I guess, the MMF, but the Louis Riel Institute in particular, we'd like to invite up Sharon Peronto to bring greetings. So please welcome Sharon.
Thanks, Wab. Does that pin actually include alumni? I'm a graduate. my name is Sharon Peronto. I'm the general manager of Louis Riel Institute, and Louis Riel Institute is the culture and education arm of the Manitoba Métis Federation. So we do a lot of work in terms of working with the province to create resources for teachers and for scholars. So if you are a scholar and you're doing any type of research on the Métis, please come on down. We've got volumes and volumes of information. So that's a great thing. I'm glad to see there are some of my students from our urban and inner city studies class. Dr. Myra Laramie and I just started teaching last night and invited some students down for the lecture, so it's good to see them here. And at the back of the room I put some of these postcards, which are is a link to a resource that we recently created with Manitoba Aboriginal and Northern Affairs, and it is an interactive learning resource on the Legislative Assembly of Assiniboia and the importance of it in the development of Manitoba and bringing Manitoba into Confederation. And I have to say that I'm really glad that Adam is here talking about this, because as Wab said, it is a very controversial issue. Lots of people think differently about are we all treaty people, and I've been, I guess dialoguing is a good word to say, with Jamie Wilson, the Treaty Commissioner, about how do the Métis people fit into this. And so one of the things that I know Louis Riel, in his memoirs, he talked about treating with the Métis people, but he had to do so with the First Nation first. So I am no means an expert in this area, so I came to learn like you did. So I look forward to the lecture.
Thank you. All right, well, miigwech, and thank you, Sharon. I'm not going to take up a ton of time because I know you all want to hear Adam. I just want to point out or highlight a few things on his academic resume, which I think speak to his perspicacity, his intelligence, and also the kind of cred that he's built up in institutions of higher learning. He did his PhD at the University of Victoria as part of their Indigenous Governance Program. And this is really, and hopefully I'm not throwing shade on anyone, including our own institution here, but UVic is really the preeminent school for Indigenous governance in North America. And while he was writing his PhD dissertation, he received a year-long fellowship to write at Yale University. So he was accredited by the preeminent school in his field, and he passed through an Ivy League institution on his way to completing that terminal degree. So we are really talking about a very bright and accomplished up-and-coming Indigenous scholar here, who I think is a testament both to what our peoples can achieve when they come into institutions like this one, but also is going to speak to something very timely, something very topical, and something very engaging. So ladies and gentlemen, let's please put our hands together for Dr. Adam Gaudry.
Hello, everyone. Thank you all for coming. I'm really excited to be here. I'm always excited when I get to go back to Winnipeg and talk about this. And I find in Manitoba, too, there's such an interest in the history of this place, and I think that's really important. And it's always good to kind of come here and talk to rooms full of people about this, because it always seems to work out that way here. And so thank you very much for taking the time out of your day to be here. Before I begin, I want to thank Wob and Sarah for bringing me out here and for setting up everything, as well as the University of Winnipeg and the Louis Riel Institute for making this possible. And I also want to acknowledge Treaty 1 and Métis territory, and of course the many other people that call this place home. By way of introduction, my name is Adam Gaudry. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Indigenous Studies at the University of Saskatchewan. My family is from Sioux Narrows, Ontario, Lake of the Woods, although came there by way of both Saskatchewan and Manitoba. And like many other Métis families, were originally here until the 1870s, where, you know, the events that I'm going to be talking about today pushed my family west and then ultimately moved back east and, you know, like a lot of Métis families, grew up. I grew up in southern Ontario, outside of the Métis homeland. So when I'm talking about Métis and treaties today, I want to do so in a way that doesn't see Métis treaty making or Métis politics and First Nations treaty making and politics as these oppositional things. Because for a long time, really, until the Indian Act, Métis and First Nations did things quite differently. And I think when we get caught up in kind of these contemporary political issues, we can often miss that. And so what I'm going to be talking about today, I don't want to set up as this kind of oppositional thing or a zero-sum game where any kind of argument in favor of Manitoba or of a Manitoba treaty with Métis people in Canada in any way detracts from Treaty 1 or challenges Treaty 1 or the other way around. Because I think, like our ancestors did, we can see this as a compatible process. Throughout all the events I'm going to be talking about today, Métis were insistent that Canada or the Crown also treat with other Indigenous peoples. And so every list of rights they produced as a negotiating position with Canada always said treaties with Indians. It was always one of the requirements for this process, because the Métis were very much aware that they were negotiating only on their own behalf and not on the behalf of anyone else. So what I'm here to do today is not in any way to detract from any of the numbered treaties or any other treaties. Okay, so to kind of get down to it, the title of this talk, are the Métis treaty people or a treaty people? And I'm going to say yes, and Métis are treaty people in a number of different ways. First off, I think most obviously, there are some Métis who are also First Nations and therefore treaty based on membership in a First Nation. And that, I think, is actually quite common. We live in a world today where we kind of discourage being both Métis and, say, Cree. But I think that we're kind of getting to a point where that is much more common, to be able to identify as both without it seeming like you're detracting from one or the other or not being, you know, committing fully to your people. But that was very common. As my colleague Rob Innes, in his excellent book, Elder Brother in Law, The People, argues that pretty much every band that was living on the prairies in the 19th century was already multicultural, and that there were different people living in these bands, often speaking different languages, you know, in their day-to-day lives, but because most people were multilinguistic in those days, could understand one another, there were different cultures practicing different ceremonies and living, you know, alongside one another. So the idea of this in the 19th century would not have been actually all that controversial. But Métis were never included in the number treaties, with a few exceptions, but for the most part were not included in the number treaties as Métis or as half-breeds, to use the language of the day. There's one notable exception in Treaty 3, but for the most part, Métis were included in the number treaties only as members of Indian bands. Métis were not party to those treaties in any kind of broad-based kind of way. But Métis were also treaty partners with First Nations already. There are a number of different examples about this. There's these kind of broad, big, grand negotiations between, say, the Dakota or a group of Dakota and a group of Métis that were negotiating a treaty to become relatives so that they wouldn't fight with one another anymore and could live, you know, and hunt alongside one another as relatives. But there is also a lot of like little treaties, little marriages, for example. Marriages are kind of like, you know, a way to create new relatives, a way to live with one another, to create obligation across families and across peoples. And so Métis and First Nations had all sorts of treaty relationships well before the number treaties and the Manitoba Treaty came into being. But what I'm going to be talking about today are really not these kinds of relationships, but a very particular treaty, which is what Riel called the Manitoba Treaty, what I'm going to call the Manitoba Treaty as well, which is a treaty that was specifically negotiated between Métis, particularly Métis, but other peoples at Red River as well, and the government of Canada in 1870. And so to kind of start this off, I'm going to presume there's some familiarity with the Red River Resistance of 1869 and 1870, which is kind of the defining moment that kind of brings us down this path where treaty making between Métis and Canada becomes a necessity. And although most historians and most jurists don't really conceive of things that way, I'm neither a historian or a jurist. I'm a political studies scholar. I'm interested in the kind of political claims Canada was making, and I'm interested in the claims that Indigenous peoples, particularly Métis people, are making in this era. And there's two kind of opposing schools of thought about who owned Manitoba in 1869 and 1870. The kind of dominant scholarly school of thought has long presumed that in 1869, the Dominion of Canada purchased the Northwest, which is most of the Hudson's Bay drainage, from the Hudson's Bay Company through the Hudson's Bay Transfer Agreement in 1869. The opposing view, the Indigenous view, which Indigenous people have long put forward from basically from before it was happening to the present, is that Canada could not have purchased the Hudson's Bay Company territory because the Hudson's Bay Company territory could not have been owned by Europeans that simply showed up on the shores of Hudson's Bay in 1668, drew some maps, and then claimed the entire drainage for themselves. Because as late as 1870 and much later in other places, Canada didn't actually Canada or the Hudson's Bay Company didn't actually control most of the land that they were claiming. It was, for all intents and purposes, still governed by Indigenous peoples. So if we were to throw out the idea that the Hudson's Bay Company owns the country through the doctrine of discovery, the idea that, you know, Indigenous peoples were too primitive to actually own and govern their land to a full extent, and therefore Europeans could just show up and claim the place as their own, we have to, of course, make sense of things through treaty making. Only by negotiating an agreement with the people who actually lived here, who actually governed and owned the land in a more substantial way, could the Hudson's Bay Company and later Canadians come to be in this place. Additionally, the British legal system has long held that before British subjects, which in those days Canadians were British subjects, could settle a land, at first, the Crown first needed to negotiate a treaty in order to allow access to that place. And that, of course, was enshrined in the Royal Proclamation of 1763. Now, there's been a movement when it comes to Métis issues and Métis history to downplay Métis indigeneity, to say that Métis were already, you know, as half European, were already subjects of the Crown and therefore not a full indigenous people, and therefore treaties were unnecessary. But in most cases, that is not how Métis saw things, and that is not how First Nations saw things either. And that Métis and First Nations largely considered Métis to be fully indigenous peoples, to at least own a share in the title to the land, and therefore eligible for treaty making, and treaty making was a requirement. Of course, as I said, there was also the practical matter of control of the land. And so while we could, you know, imagine, you know, Charles II claiming, you know, the entire Hudson's Bay drainage for, you know, the Hudson's Bay Company and the Hudson's Bay Company Charter of 1670, the reality of enforcing that was much different. And so in many cases, treaties were also a practical necessity for moving settlers on to indigenous territories. So leading up to this Manitoba Treaty in 1869, there was this long-standing negotiation between Canada and the Hudson's Bay Company for Canada to purchase the company's claim in order to settle people in places such as this. And this entire debate was actually recorded in the local newspaper, the Nor'wester. And so Métis were very much aware of what was going on. They could follow the debates that were happening in London, that were happening in Ottawa, the kind of desire of certain, particularly Ontarians, to come and settle the land and turn this into a, you know, basically another Ontario. They were watching all of these debates unfold in their local paper. And so by the time Canada had kind of settled this and decided to send someone out to, you know, officially take control of the land, a man named William McDougall, who was the first lieutenant governor of the Northwest, the Métis were already ready for this eventuality. And what they did was they erected a roadblock, which is, I think, an inauguration of a proud indigenous tradition in Canada. They erected a roadblock, organized themselves into a buffalo hunt government, armed themselves, and basically prevented the governor from arriving in the territory, and formed what would become, ultimately, the provisional government of Assiniboia. And so this was modeled initially after a buffalo hunt model, where Métis kind of chose their leaders from amongst themselves, organized parties of soldiers that were capable of defending the territory or defending their hunt caravan. But over time, and by bringing in more people until it represented essentially the entire settlement, which wasn't all Métis, but mostly Métis, the provisional government of Assiniboia basically became the authority, you know, for the Red River settlement, what, you know, basically now what is Greater Winnipeg. And so the provisional government then was ultimately responsible for, you know, expelling Canadian authority, keeping Canadian authority out, and assuring that Métis and other peoples that were living here were in control of their own affairs. And by 1870, it had formed into a government that had its own legislature. It had an executive, which is pictured here with Louis Riel, of course, in the center of it as the president. And it had even a nominal judiciary. And so it set itself up to a, you know, based, I think, on a buffalo hunt principles of kind of direct democracy, an elected leadership responsible to the people, but also kind of took a form that was kind of more understandable to European authorities that were used to legislatures and kind of a clear authority in all circumstances, like a president, that could kind of speak on behalf of the people. So this was a democratic body, and in many ways it was kind of more directly democratic than a lot of governments that existed in its day. And it had a legislature initially of 24 that kind of fluctuated around, but it was based on a principle of equal representation between English-speaking parishes and French-speaking parishes, and this kind of unity of two distinct language groups that were in many ways heavily intermarried. But what's particularly important for our purposes today is that in December of 1869, this new governing body published a declaration, which it's called the Declaration of the Peoples of Rupert's Land and the Northwest, which was its first public statement, which I think very clearly articulated the way that most Métis would have seen political relationships in the Red River Settlement and in the larger Northwest. And one of the first things that this document did was openly reject Canadian authority. And it reads, quote, "We refuse to recognize the authority of Canada, which pretends to have a right to govern and impose upon us a despotic form of government." And so most of the document actually reads like this. There's a lot of kind of accusations of despotism on the part of Canada. There's kind of this refusal to acknowledge Canadian authority. They talk about being subjected to Hudson's Bay Company governance. And basically it kind of ends with stating that, you know, now this provisional government is the body that's kind of in charge. But it doesn't end that way, because what it does at the end is actually set the stage for a negotiation. So one of the last sentences of the document reads, "We hold ourselves in readiness to enter into such negotiations with the Canadian government as may be favorable for the good government and prosperity of this people." So on the one hand, Métis were quite cautious, I think, about Canada. But on the other, were willing to entertain the idea of negotiating some sort of compromise position. And they did so because at the time, and this is something we, I think, don't often think about, but Métis were one of the wealthiest and most powerful peoples on the prairies. They had, well, Métis traders at least, had done exceptionally well with the pemmican trade and then the Buffalo Road trade, and were in many ways wealthy, powerful, horse-owning people that were willing and able to fight. They were good allies for the people they are allied with. They were feared enemies. And Métis were, I think, both aware of this and cognizant that times were changing. And so their goal was to maintain as much as possible this kind of status on the prairies as a people, a collective entity that was a good ally, you know, but also somebody that could control their own destiny. And so this is, I think, what was motivating Métis, the desire to keep this position and, in a changing world, to be able to capitalize off these changes and to ensure, as things transitioned, that they would remain kind of at the core of political decision-making in their homeland. And so upon receiving this declaration in Ottawa, the government of Canada actually appointed three delegates to speak to this provisional government and to kind of create a situation where a negotiation was possible. And so they send Donald A. Smith, who is the future Lord Strathcona, a prominent fur trader, and he goes to the Legislative Assembly of Assiniboia, the provisional government's legislature, and he reads to them a note from Canada inviting the people to send, quote, "a delegation of two or more of the residents of Red River, as they may think best, the delegation to confer with the government and legislature of Canada." And I think this is an important piece of information, because on the one hand, Métis have already kind of set up this kind of dynamic. You don't belong here, you don't have the authority to be here, but we're willing to negotiate something that will allow you to do those things. On the other hand, we have a Canadian government that read that and then sent a delegation to basically say, well, send two or more of your own people, send them to Ottawa, and we can start talking about this. And the decision of Donald A. Smith to go not to just, you know, a big public assembly, which had happened already, but to this governing body and say, send two people, I think is a very obvious statement of what we would now call a nation-to-nation relationship. It was an initiation of one group of people with their government, approaching another government in order to talk about how to live together. So the provisional government had offered to negotiate initially, and now Canada was inviting delegates to Ottawa to do just that. Now the provisional government, through a very kind of formalized legislative process, appointed three delegates and sent them to Ottawa. I'm not going to have time to get too much into the kind of dynamics of that, but they were Abbé Richot, a French priest, who was there to represent the French portion of the population, Judge John Black, there to represent the English, and by far the most conservative of the three, and Alfred Scott, there to represent a small population of Americans living in the settlement, but I think the kind of consensus now is he was there because the Americans were largely Métis-friendly and wanted to kind of bolster the kind of French backing of the delegation. And so upon their arrival in Ottawa, there was some kind of things with that. They were arrested first, and then the government appointed actually one of their sitting MPs as their lawyer, which I think shows the government's support to kind of get them out of jail. There was the whole Thomas Scott thing, which interestingly, nobody really wanted to talk about. You know, it's like a big deal in the history books, but no Canadian politician, they would always just kind of say, oh yeah, we know something, you know, bad happened, but we want to put that behind us. Like, they didn't even really want to name it. It like wasn't something that they wanted to interfere with things. And so when the negotiations actually began, the delegation from Red River, the demand that they made was before we get started, we need to be recognized as representatives of the people of the Northwest, or the representatives of the provisional government. There's some wrangling over who the government of Canada was willing to recognize them as the representatives over. Ultimately, they settled on representatives of the Northwest, but they were acknowledged as the representatives of a group of people that had sent delegations to Ottawa. Interestingly, at the same time, the people they're negotiating with, Sir John A. Macdonald and Sir Georges Etienne Cartier, both are also recognized as the delegates representing Canada. So this, once again, is this nation-to-nation relationship being set up. Two governments, or two groups of people sending their, you know, some of their most powerful leaders in order to negotiate some sort of agreement that everyone can live by. So this creates a type of parity between Canada and the Northwest, or Canada and Assiniboia, whatever we want to call kind of this space, which, you know, the name is constantly changing. But they're there ultimately to negotiate a treaty with one another. And although Canada at times tends to avoid that word, in Abbé Richot's journal, which is the sole surviving firsthand account of these negotiations, the word treat or treaty is used throughout. And it implies this dual recognition. And although we kind of deny that it was a treaty relationship today, or at least certain scholars do, I'm not sure that Canada and Canada's later interpretation of this can be considered the sole authority. Because Métis are equally able to interpret what this means, and that interpretation should be given equal weight. And the ultimate kind of conclusion by most Métis that were involved in this, including Abbé Richot, who's a French priest, was that it was a treaty relationship. The ultimate agreement was something that involved, in many ways, compromises by both parties. Some kind of key things were given up. It became a province and not a territory with a democratic and elected legislature. There was a large Métis land reserve set aside for Métis. In exchange, this was a province that really until the 30s didn't control its own natural resources. That fell under federal jurisdiction. But for the most part, this was something that everybody could live with. It did three things. It set aside lands for the current people living there, and the Métis and half-breed children. It ensured a parity of language between English and French, so it was a bilingual province, at least until the 1890s. And this language parity stood in very much for political equality between two major populations at Red River. It would be something that, you know, two groups of people would be living, you know, in the same province and would in many ways be considered politically equal. But the most important part of the agreement was that it ensured a long-standing Métis political power in the province, in which Métis would control the political apparatus immediately, and even if they ceased to be the majority of the population, because they were about 80% of the population in those days, that there would be enough of a political infrastructure in place that their interests will be protected long time into the future. Say, like, the English minority in Quebec. So in terms of lands, there's a tendency in kind of previous study to interpret Métis lands as basically being parceled out by Canada because Canada had the jurisdiction over the lands in order to do that. But the original agreement actually involved this creation of a Métis land reserve of 1.4 million acres, which is now called Section 31 lands. There was the Manitoba Métis Federation court case dealing with this particular issue. But the original agreement, which wasn't represented by the Manitoba Act, involved a Métis land reserve that would be governed by a committee of members that would ensure that the people who were given this land were Métis, and that if they decided to sell the portion of the 1.4 million acres, the only eligible buyers would be other Métis. So the idea is that there would be this large reserve set up for Métis children that could basically sell their land only to Métis, ensuring that in perpetuity it would be held by Métis. They also guaranteed that everybody living on the lands they were currently living on would be recognized as owning those lands in fee simple, and so a significant portion of the new province of Manitoba, which is, where is it, the postage stamp, Manitoba, over 1/7 of the lands would actually be held in fee simple by Métis, which of course would protect Métis interests well into the future. And like I said, they didn't necessarily preclude any kind of other treaty relationship, any kind of other land distribution for other Indigenous peoples living in this new province. They just simply wanted to make sure that they had some of their own. The kind of second key component, like I said, is language. It was meant to ensure this kind of political equality, but also to kind of protect Métis language rights, particularly the French-speaking Métis, to ensure that their language was protected, that they could speak it in the legislature, and that their language would be given equal political weight. But the political apparatus, I think, is the key component that keeps all of this kind of working. Because Manitoba wasn't really going to be just another province. It would be kind of, at least I think how it was envisioned, was this kind of exceptional province in the way Quebec is exceptional. It is, yes, a part of Canada, yes, a part of Confederation, but its fundamental political character represents a different people than kind of Anglo-Canada. And so this would be a Métis province in the way that Quebec is a province for the Québécois. It was designed to have a long-term Métis presence within it. And the political institutions would be, over the long term, run by the Métis. For example, there was a Senate that this new province would have. And the proposal for the Senate from the provisional government was to start appointing kind of old guard Senate appointees that were already in the political leadership of the Red River settlement so that when it became a province of Manitoba within Canada, that they would have these people appointed for life that were there to protect the long-term interests of the people. And for those of you who may not be familiar with the Canadian parliamentary system, the Senate can actually shoot down legislation from the elected portion of the legislature. And so this would basically be a check. If, for example, there was a Anglo majority in Manitoba, that the Senate could actually prevent certain laws that would undermine Métis rights, Métis authority within the new Manitoba, because they would have this appointed Senate from the old guard of the settlement. They also wanted a one-year residency restriction placed on voting. The original idea was 3 years, so that you would have to live in Manitoba for 3 years before you were eligible to vote, which would slow down the possibility of having a non-Métis voting majority. So it would protect the ability of Métis to elect their own governments in the new province. And with all of this in place, the ultimate idea was that Métis would be able to remain in their own homeland. They would have a province, at least for the foreseeable future, that they would control. And that they could control its institutions and ensure that there was enough land for their community to grow in place without having to leave as most, or some Métis at least, ultimately did. Now this agreement, it should be noted, was actually ratified by the Parliament of Canada in the Manitoba Act. So I see the Manitoba Act and the Manitoba Treaty as two separate things. The Manitoba Treaty is this fundamental agreement containing the kinds of things I've talked about. The Manitoba Act was how the Government of Canada legalized it. There was a second motion made in the Legislative Assembly of Assiniboia here to ratify it based on, you know, to make it compatible with the laws of the legislature that was already in place. So there's this dual ratification process. You know, and despite kind of this common notion that Sir John A. Macdonald was negotiating in bad faith and that Canada never really intended to follow through with it, he says some very interesting things in the legislature when the Manitoba Bill, the eventual Manitoba Act, is being debated that ultimately leads me to think otherwise. So the government of Canada, the governing party at the time was the Conservative Party, and they actually defended it, I think, quite valiantly in the House of Commons against a fairly firm Liberal opposition. And there was a bunch of hostile amendments, things that would basically undermine the entire agreement, and the governing party, the Conservatives, voted it down and held to the original agreement. There was actually only one time that the legislation was amended, which would expand the province westward to include Portage-la-Prairie. But before the government was willing to do this, they actually went back to the Red River delegation and asked them permission first. In order to change the agreement, they wanted to make sure that this wouldn't ruin the whole process. And this is, again, why I think it's an important, it's a negotiation, right? If Canada could really do whatever it wanted, it wouldn't have felt compelled to go back and agree to make changes just so it can get through Parliament. So Macdonald then vocally defended the existence of this 1.4 million acre reserve. He defended the existence of elective institutions, even in a province that would have an Indigenous majority within it. And he repeatedly used the phrase freely consenting, or freely consenting people. And so at one point where he's debating with the Liberals who want to ensure that there's no federal representation from Manitoba so that Manitoba wouldn't be able to send members of Parliament to Ottawa, he says, in defense of that, that free men, how else would free men consent to be united with Canada unless they were guaranteed fair representation in Parliament? And so Sir John A. Macdonald, who did a lot of awful things, was actually a pretty strong defender of this entire process, which I find interesting. And so were several other Conservative members of Parliament. Adams Archibald, who would become the first Lieutenant Governor of Manitoba, said that we can enter Canada not as conquerors, but as pacifiers, by which I think he means more like in a peacemaking role, and shall satisfy the people there that we have no selfish object of our own to accomplish, but that we go there for their good as well as for our own. And then the government of Canada, after all this debate, the governing party passed this legislation quite substantially. It sailed through the Senate with really not a lot of objections. And I think this is interesting because if the government of Canada was interested in watering things down, this was the opportunity to do it. But instead, they took a very strong public stance, one that would prove to be quite unpopular. But they chose to prioritize the negotiation over their own popularity. And I think that this is important. So with whatever what happens afterwards, which I think is deeply problematic, the government of Canada, I think, at least negotiated in good faith, and that we can look to this agreement as something that's both viable and something that can continue to exist as a kind of unfulfilled obligation. Now, like I said, it didn't end here. That's why it's not just the Manitoba Act that we should be talking about. Because this agreement was brought back to Red River, and the provisional government insisted on ratifying the legislation itself, This is that kind of parity, that nation-to-nation agreement. Because according to them, Canada alone did not have the capacity to legislate into existence their new government. This was an agreement, and they were a part of that agreement, and their legislature was required in order to put that agreement into action. And so about a month after Canada ratified the agreement through the Manitoba Act, the Legislative Assembly of Assiniboia ratified the agreement in June of 1870. And so this is, I think, the moment where we should look to where the treaty takes effect, is in June of 1870. However, when this treaty takes effect, Métis begin to behave quite differently with their own government. And I think that's because they understood the provisional government, the government they created, as the transitional government into the province. And interestingly, the first province, the first provincial legislature, had the same number of seats with a very similar distribution as the provisional government. So basically, the province would just kind of, the provisional government would flow into the provincial government. It had a very similar set of institutions. The body was mostly the same. And Métis began to pass laws leading up to June of 1870 that were to take effect and have kind of a long-term, something like liquor licenses, for example. They had a deadline in December of 1870 when they could reasonably presume that the agreement would have been concluded by then, which leads me to believe that they were assuming that the laws they were passing as the provisional government of Assiniboia would be the laws that took effect when it became the province of Manitoba. And so in many ways, Métis were assuming their government as it existed now would basically just transition into the new province. However, all of that changes, and I think this is a, kind of another key historical event. So where things kind of could have been very different was when the Wolseley expedition shows up. And I think it's interesting, this guy's name's all over Winnipeg, right? But Wolseley was a British officer who was in charge of sending an expedition of both British regulars and Canadian militia to Manitoba to ensure that this wouldn't turn into basically the American West, which was lawless, you know, death in the streets. But by their arrival, they basically ensured that that is exactly what happened. So they kind of, you know, go through the wilderness, and then they get to Manitoba, and where there's supposed to be a civil transfer of power, the new lieutenant governor shows up, he calls elections, the provisional government of Assiniboia ends, the province of Manitoba begins, Wolseley shows up before this happens. So rather than having a lieutenant governor there to ensure this peaceful transfer of power, this guy shows up, literally chases the provisional government out of Fort Garry, sends people like Riel into hiding, and this is the only point where the Thomas Scott affair becomes a major issue, and disperses the government. He then appoints Donald Smith, a HBC trader, as the kind of temporary governor of the settlement because he doesn't want it to be a military government. But this, at this point, is where the treaty breaks down. Because there's no transition, there's no peaceful transition. There's a break between that kind of transitionary government into the province of Manitoba, and there is lawlessness in the streets. And members of the provisional government and backers of the provisional government are actually murdered. And in one case, with Alzire Goulet, there's a park named after him, I believe on the other side of the river. People witnessed his death. He's swimming across the river to escape attackers. He's struck with a stone, knocked unconscious, and drowned. People witnessed this happen in large numbers. People know who did it and know who are responsible, but no one is brought to justice for it. And so this kind of, I think, sets the new tone for the new province. And it is decidedly not a Métis province. And that the soldiers that came with this expedition become the first wave of settlers, and then people like them arrive and are supported by them, and it fundamentally changes the character. And I think from this moment, this arrival of Wolseley's troops, the chasing of Riel out of the fort, the dispersal of the provisional government, is where it ceases to be a treaty Manitoba and becomes ultimately a settler colonial Manitoba instead. But here's some soldiers standing outside of a Métis home. And it's at this point where the political dynamics change, where Métis cease to be this very kind of powerful prairie people that can command kind of one of the dominant military forces of the day. And so ultimately, if they're pushed, they can push back. You know, and while some Métis that were involved with the provisional government make their way into the provincial government and its legislature, it has a very different character than it would have were people like Riel eligible to stand for election. You know, what if Riel was the first premier, not just the president of the provisional government? How different would Manitoba be in that case? And it is because of this, not because of the intent in Ottawa, but the practical realities on the ground, that the Manitoba Treaty never materializes. And so I like to think of this as there are really two Manitobas. There's this one, the one we're living in, and then there's the Manitoba that exists as a set of obligations. There's a Manitoba that could still come into existence that has a definitively Métis character to it. So while a treaty Manitoba would be negotiated and bilateral, this settler colonial Manitoba that emerges is legislated from Ottawa and is largely unilateral. Where in a treaty Manitoba, Métis people would be a central part of the new province, the settler colonial Manitoba ultimately prioritizes settler access to lands. Where a treaty Manitoba had a Métis-governed land reserve, a settler colonial Manitoba instead has Métis reserve lands that were distributed through the scrip system, not protected against outside ownership, and Métis very quickly lose this 1.4 million acre reserve. A treaty Manitoba would have had a civil transfer of power, and that transitional, you know, government role would have been filled by the provisional government. But a settler colonial Manitoba instead has a military occupation as a transfer of power. You know, where a treaty Manitoba would be a long-term Métis home, a settler colonial Manitoba sees instead a large exodus of Métis pushed to places like Saskatchewan and Alberta and augmenting the numbers of Métis settlements outside of the postage stamp Manitoba. So is Louis Riel then a father of Confederation? So the kind of conventional knowledge on this is that initially the conventional knowledge was he was not. And then I think for very good reasons, the conventional knowledge shift to say Louis Riel actually is a father of Confederation. He was instrumental in the founding of Manitoba. And I still think that's true. But I think it's also not quite appropriate to say that Louis Riel founded this Manitoba. This is not Riel's province. I think that's very clear. I think it's safe to say that this didn't pan out for us. But like I said, that doesn't mean that it can't. And that I think that the original intent of the Manitoba Treaty outlines a set of obligations to Canada if it wishes to maintain the kind of legitimacy of a political presence here, that it has an obligation to fulfill this treaty. And of course, all of the other number of treaties that it has not yet fully implemented either. And I think the Manitoba Treaty then is an excellent framework for understanding how we as Métis and how our treaty partners, Canada, can renew our political relationship with one another. In fact, the creation of a significant size land reserve with, say, provincial-like powers and an equal voice in the Confederation's Confederation of Provinces, which is, I think, what lies at the heart of this agreement, can allow us to envision the creation of such an entity. This doesn't necessarily need to be in one place. Obviously, Métis are now much more dispersed than we were in those days. But we can also envision a confederacy of smaller Métis settlements or Métis communities that could possess provincial-like powers with the combined political power of the Métis Nation. you know, I can't ultimately say what form this should take, but I think that is the starting point for some discussions that need to happen. And so whatever form this renewed treaty relationship will ultimately take, we can be sure of ultimately two things. First, that the current political relationship here is not working. And second, that both the Canadian people and the Métis Nation have an obligation to do something about it. Thank you very much.
Hey, that was awesome. So we have about 10 minutes for a Q&A. I'll just lead off with a question to get the thing rolling here. How would the Manitoba Treaty, as you describe it, interface with Treaty 1? Because the lands that you're talking about are the most valuable lands in Treaty 1. And so how could those two things work together, and how can both the Métis and the Treaty 1 First Nations claim Aboriginal title over the same land? Can you talk about that for a little bit?
Yeah, and that of course is like the question, right? And while I wouldn't want to speak for anyone, but ultimately, like, I think the idea of shared title is not like a radical departure from past practice. I think the idea of, you know, one group, one title is actually like a very kind of recent invention for these parts, and it comes with the, like, kind of this notion of sovereignty, crown sovereignty, and the idea that kind of multiple people can live on the same land and own the same land collectively is, I think, a very kind of old school Indigenous concept. And so I hope this isn't a cop out, but kind of returning to that kind of understanding, I think, is kind of the key first step. Obviously, dialogue is going to be a very important part of that. I know at one point there was a treaty relationship that was begun by the Métis Nation of Ontario and I believe Treaty 3 chiefs that was kind of the start of that. I don't think it's kind of lasted, but it was a step in that direction. And I think that those, for kind of our relationships, are kind of the key first steps in figuring those sorts of things out. I think ultimately sharing the land is something we've done for a couple hundred years now, and so that I think is kind of the underlying goal. It would be to continue to do that. Yeah.
Cool. So part of decolonizing is about returning to a more Indigenous conception of land ownership and title, and dialogue between Indigenous nations and the political entities representing them is an important step towards achieving that.
Yeah.
Very good. All right. Questions from the floor, Mr. Catchaway.
You got, my name is Tim Catchaway. I'm from Skowhegan First Nation, which is located in Treaty 2 territory. I found your talk very, very insightful and interesting. One thing that caught my attention was the letter that was sent from the federal government to the provincial provisional government of Assiniboia, requesting two, you call them negotiators, but they weren't called negotiators by the federal government. They were called simply residents of that place. And then you made the connection between them being the representatives of the government, but they weren't actually recognized by the federal government in that letter that was sent. They were just simply asking for a couple of people, two or more, to come and talk. And then the jump was made that they were, that was the federal government acknowledging them as a government, as a legitimate government. But in what was said, that wasn't the case. Is that?
Yeah. And there's like a language game I think the federal government is playing throughout this process. They're trying to use language to, I think, disguise the reality of what is going on. But I think it's one of those like actions speak louder than words scenarios. Like, because they ultimately know they can't pass this legislation or change the legislation that's going through Parliament without conferring back with the people that they were negotiating with and ensuring that they're okay with it. And so, like, I think it comes down to one of those. It's like a conception that the language of the law is more important than the intent of the law. They're trying to use a type of language to minimize this, which disguises, I think, the fundamental character, which is that it's a negotiated compromise position that, like I said, Canada doesn't have the power to interpret that absolutely on its own, right? It's something that you know, that the Métis interpretation of it, which is a treaty-making relationship based on binding negotiation, should be given equal weight. And so that's kind of what I'm trying to put forward here. But I think ultimately the federal government, that's the game they're playing, is they're trying to minimize what's happening by using a language to detract from that. But I think at the end of the day, I think McDonald knows what's going down, and he has very little choice. Because until that military occupation, Canada can't do anything here that the local people aren't willing to do. So, like, I think at the end of the day, Canada is well aware of its weak position, and they try to use language to minimize it, but ultimately I think they know what's going on, which is it's negotiation, yeah.
And the point that I heard you make in the talk is that it's about who they sent the letter to. They didn't just send a letter to all residents of Manitoba saying, hey, why don't you guys volunteer two of yourselves? They sent it specifically to the provincial government.
They actually tried that, because before that offer was made, the same commissioner, Donald Smith, he has this big public meeting, and he makes a similar invitation, and then all the people at Red River are like, okay, let's form a government, and then they form a government.
And then they engage with
that government. And then he has to make that to the government. So, like, again, they like, it's kind of this... Some of it is a bit, what am I trying to say here? It's like a bit of a show, but at the same time, they want him to know what's going on, I think.
All right, we got time probably for one more question. Sharon, I can give you closing comments if you want to leave time for one question from the floor. Okay. Well, Tim, you already asked a question. Do you want to ask a question? Yeah.
Hi, thanks for the talk. I was just wondering, you talked about the breakdowns of the peaceful negotiations coming about because of the military kind of delegation coming.
Yeah.
And you also talked about not believing that Ottawa negotiated in bad faith. You thought they acted in good faith. So I'm wondering, I'm having trouble kind of with that juxtaposition there, and I'm wondering what was the purpose of the military expedition if it wasn't for... basically to chase out the provisional government.
Yeah. The agreement, and I don't think that either the provisional government or the delegates from Red River actually ever agreed to it, but they didn't disagree with it. But I think the idea was it was supposed to be mostly British regulars who are, and kind of like a lot of other Indigenous people, the Crown is kind of seen as a more neutral party. And so the idea was if it was mostly British soldiers under a British commander, that the job was to keep the peace, then it could actually ensure that the agreement got implemented. And so I think that that's kind of the reason that Métis didn't really kick up a fuss. Although at one point, Riel was actually trying to put together his own army. So there would basically be two military elements in the settlement and were kind of offsetting one another. But I think that broke down and I think people were buffalo hunting is, I think, what ultimately kind of, because it's the summer now, kind of prevented that. But I think that there was an attempt for that too. But But I think what really kind of throws that expedition into a disarray is not actually the commander or the British. It's all of the Canadian militiamen that go with it. That they're the kind of shock troops of settler colonialism, I think, in that case. Yeah.
I guess one of the things that Justice Sinclair says in his Truth and Reconciliation is that it really is up to the children to actually move our reconciliation forward, right? And I think that with treaty education being throughout school, that kids are learning about treaties in all grades, right? And so I have grandchildren that go to school right now, and they're starting to learn about it, and they really know that they're Métis. Yeah. And so what do I say to them? And what do I say to when I work with the treaty relations people about how do the Métis fit into this? Mm-hmm. What do I say?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, what I would say is kind of that, like, I, you know... Treaty 1 isn't the only treaty here. Like, even if we don't talk about the Manitoba Treaty, like, there's the Selkirk Treaty, you know, the Iron Alliance, you know, you know, Plain Soto or you know, Prairie Anishinaabe came here from somewhere else and were invited in, right? This space has always been this kind of place where people kind of moved on to and you know, people welcome them, which was the intent behind Treaty 1 and the Manitoba Treaty. So, like, I think we can talk about multiple treaties in a place without necessarily detracting from the significance of any of them. Like, I think they're all important. If it taught in a way, and I think it would have to be taught in a way, we can learn about more than one treaty in a place without it, you know, detracting from the centrality of say Treaty 1. And like I've been kind of saying throughout, like, I don't want this to be an either or situation. And like Wob was saying, like, we have, between the different Indigenous peoples, we have stuff to work out too. We had agreements that I think are still more fundamental than our relationships with Canada. They're certainly much older. So we can, you know, while we're talking about treaty with the kind of Canadian public, we also have to kind of talk about treaties amongst ourselves as well. Yeah.
Just as a quick follow, the Treaty Relations Commission works with the Dakota, you know, and the Dakota never signed a treaty in Manitoba with the Canadian state, right? So TRCM works with the Dakota. You'd think that they should be able to work with the Métis as well. So I'm going to invite up the President and Vice Chancellor of the University of Winnipeg, Dr. Annette Trimby, who is herself Métis and is a lake scientist by trade. And she's going to offer some closing comments and also, you know, closing greetings to you all.
Well, thank you, Wob, and thanks everybody for coming. And it's nice to know that I'm not the only confused person, so Sharon's confused as well. So the thing about your lecture that always hits me is I think about my Métis great-grandfather, who was probably 19, 20 years old in 1869, 1870, and how he would have viewed his possibilities and how pumped he would have been. And then I think of my grandmother, born in 1895, and how things had changed. So, anyways, what I really want to say is I'm very impressed with your polarity thinking, because I'm a big believer in the power of and rather than either or. And I want to thank Wob and Zara for bringing you here. I want to thank Wob for asking the question that I think was so important to have asked and answered at this point in time at the University of Winnipeg, because I sometimes feel a little bit of tension. I don't know how to put my arms around it. I don't know what it really means. All I know is wherever I am, I'm kind of on the edge, right? So am I in? Am I out? Am I a scientist? Am I a bureaucrat? Am I this? Am I that? So I guess it means I'm Métis and I'm from Winnipeg. And I'm going to learn, I promised Wob I would learn a little bit of Anishinaabe over Christmas. So Annette Trimby, Nindishinakaz, got that right? Where am I from? Weenibigong. Did I get that right? All right. I'm with you so far. So I need a little bit of practice, and I'm probably going to show up at your Tuesday sessions on occasion when I'm in town. So, Adam, brilliant. Thank you for coming. Thank you for what you do. It's incredibly important. And thanks, everybody, for coming.